Very good morning to all of you, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this sixth CK Prahalad Memorial Lecture here today on the occasion of his 76th birthday. No better day than this when we could have had this very important lecture series, and we have a guest who is the son of the soil and well known to each and everyone in this audience. Well, as I mentioned, this is the sixth lecture series. We started it in 2012, and you know that we lost Mr. C.K. Professor C.K. Prahalad in 2010, but we do strongly take forward the contributions that he had left behind, both for India as well as all of us at the CII, and many of it has been on a mission mode since his departure. And in fact, in some of the projects he was involved in fact, he helped us start each one of them. And when we do this celebration for a week for a project which is extremely important for us, which is known as India at 75, which was again started by him through his thoughts, his actions, we celebrate the India at 75 week starting from 8th of August every year. And again, this year we are indeed fortunate to start it on a day of on his birthday, which is the 8th. And here we are joined by his family, Mrs. Gayatri Prahalad, his wife, Deepa, and of course Murli. The involvement of the Prahalad family in this entire journey, when I talked about India at 75, has been one very single important factor of motivation, which has come to a large number of people across the country who has been involved in this movement and this mission. And had it not been the participation of the family, it would not have been really complete in terms of how the entire agenda setting exercise that has been done, keeping them fully involved. My welcome and my sincere thanks to Mrs. Prahalad, Deepa, and you, Murli, for really being with us, coming down specially from the US for this function. And not only today, but they are going to be traveling in different parts of the country, being involved to see and contribute on how we are able to take some of the great thoughts that Professor Prahalad has left behind. Ladies and gentlemen, as I mentioned, we have an outstanding speaker here today for this memorial lecture, Dr. Nandan Nilekani. Again, somebody who is like Professor Prahalad, if I can say, both of them having given us a huge opportunity to connect with the mass of the country, if one can say, the people of India, through their work, through their respective work, of which all of you know, and I'm not going to get into the details and what they have both worked on. But their works, their writings have inspired us in getting a huge involvement of people across the country in many movements where we have seen opportunity areas of business to get involved, be it with the rural economy, be it with the bottom of the pyramid, and the vision that also Mr. Nandan Nilekani's work has left behind, and the work that he has left behind in the through his Aadhaar scheme, which is all very well known, actually takes forward a lot in terms of connecting the people of India and talking and really fulfilling the aspirations of the people of India. And he follows a series of great speakers, actually, which we have been fortunate to have in this exercise of the C.K. Prahalad Memorial Lecture. And I must say the people that have graced this occasion in the past have been all very important and illustrious people. And it's good to recap the type of people who have really come. And very incidentally, the person who is going to moderate and chair this session with Mr. Nandan Nilekani is Dr. Naushad Forbes, who was the first speaker way back in 2012 for this memorial lecture. Last year, you were there in the last year. And the others who have been participating have been people like the RBI governor at that point in time, Mr. Ramadurai of the then Tatas and the National Skill Development Corporation, Mr. Gopalakrishnan, again, from the Tata Sons, and GVK's Sanjay Reddy. So it's been a good journey through these memorial lectures that we have had so far, and we would really be looking forward to this discussion. I'm going to leave the job of introducing the subject and of course the illustrious speaker to Dr. Naushad Forbes, who is going to be really moderating the session. But I'd like to end with one important point once again, the point that I talked about a little earlier, that's on India at 75. This has been a great work which has been done through in a mission mode for the last 10 years. We started it when India was 60, and again, it was a clarion call given, if I can say, by Professor Prahalad, who said that we need to look forward and look forward to how India could be in 2022, which is when India will be 75. And that's a huge project which was started involving all walks of people from all walks of life. And today, as you see, the government of India has also been recognizing the type of work that India needs to do, the type of achievement that it needs to do by 2022, when we talk about skills, when we talk about urbanization, when we talk about education, and so on and so forth. In fact, even on the rural side, about doubling of the farmers' income, much of it has been discussed, and we have seen how some of this can be implemented across the country by different stakeholders. And many of the stakeholders who have been contributing to this work of India at 75 are all present in this room. So we have in fact documented what we have been working on in this project, so that it can be shared with each one of you and we can get more of your involvement. I'll request actually Rajan, who is also present here, Rajan Navani, who has been a member of the India at 75 board, a trust which has been formed, and he has been actually chairing a committee within CII called the India at 75 Committee for the last 10 years. And this particular committee has been actually instrumental in implementing all the projects which come under India at 75. But ladies and gentlemen, I would like to once again specially welcome each one of you to this function, and which is being organized by the Ananta Aspen Center, one of the leading well-established think tanks of India, which is headquartered in Delhi. Mrs. Kiran Patricia is the CEO of this institution, and this lecture series has been supported all through by CII. With that, I'll request Rajan to please come up onto the dais and present the document which captures what India at 75 has been doing and what India at 75 looks forward to do in the next 5 years, which is really the countdown to 2022. And to receive this document, may I request Mrs. Prahalad to please come up onto the stage and take this documentation from Rajan. May I also request the Ananta Aspen Center's Executive Director and CEO, Ms. Kiran Pastricha, to come in. And I'll request also make a request to Mr. Tarun Das, who is also present here, who has been the founder of the Ananta Aspen Center, and also, as you know, the former chief mentor of the Confederation of Indian Industry. Thank you, and over to Naushad.
Thank you, Chandrajit, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be with you here this morning in Bangalore. It's a particular privilege to be with you for the sixth C.K. Prahalad Memorial Lecture. And it's a particular privilege, especially, to have the Prahalad family with us this morning. C.K. Prahalad, as you know, was one of the great management theorists of the last 50 years. He wrote so brilliantly in a manner that instructed the world, that provided insight across so many different topics. But as a management theorist, as someone who provided great intellectual leadership, C.K. always wanted his management theory and his intellectual leadership to have a social purpose. There was always a social purpose to all of his writings. And he concerned himself especially with the question of what is technology, what is economic development, what is good management actually at the end of the day for? And that question of what is technology or what is economic development for, I think provides a perfect bridge to talking about Nandan. I'm not going to talk about Nandan's many achievements. The usual introduction is a man who needs no introduction and then you get a long introduction. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to say instead just one sentence, which is that when Nandan is listed here this morning, he is listed as the chairman of EkStep and the former chairman of the Unique Identification Authority of India. And these achievements are so signal that they displace his relatively minor former achievement of being the co-founder of Infosys. Nandan, to me, really exemplifies all that is good in India. He combines an outstanding career and achievement in the private sphere with then moving into the public sphere and into the world of public service in a way that has inspired us all, but has inspired me personally. And I think his emphasis on public service, his devotion to public service, and his desire to do the right thing and to contribute and add value is something that is truly striking and impressive. But there are two more achievements that, to me, are particularly wonderful. For me, when I've tried to do anything in public service, I sort of have these separate buckets in my head. I have what I do in the company, and I have what I do in public service through a national development institution that is CII. But when Nandan does it, he somehow combines his own domain knowledge with public service. And that, to me, is a truly unique achievement. Because to take his great and deep knowledge of technology and to apply it to improving public service and to making his contribution in public service, as he did with UID, I think is something that is truly striking. And that's what he's doing now also with EkStep. There's a second unique thing that Nandan does, which is quite striking, and that is that he's a great communicator. There are other great communicators, many of them in Delhi, but Nandan is a particularly great communicator of difficult concepts and of this wonderful combination, again, of how technology can be used for public purpose, how technology can be used for social good. So I think without any more comments, I'll give you Nandan. I'm going to go and sit there so that we're going to give Nandan free run of the stage. And then we'll come back to some questions and answers in a bit. Thanks, Nandan.
Thank you. Thank you, Naushad. And first of all, it's really great to be here to give this memorial lecture in honor of Professor C.K. Prahalad. For me, he was a friend, a mentor, and a teacher. And I've gained remarkably and immeasurably from my interactions with him. And I'm very happy that Gayatri, Murli, and Deepa are also here for this lecture. Professor Prahalad taught me many lessons. One is that the most difficult poverty is the poverty of imagination, and that if we can imagine and think in a breakthrough manner, then a lot can be accomplished. And I think that's something which I take back with me. Also, I think his extraordinary commitment to India and its future was very, very palpable. I still remember that he and I, we had dinner together in Singapore in 2006 at the IMF World Bank meetings, and we talked about all the things that can be done, and it's really very unfortunate that he left us in an untimely manner. We also, there's a connection to the work I have done. There was a note which three great Indian intellectuals put together, Professor C.K. Prahalad, Dr. Raghuram Rajan, and Professor Abhijit Banerjee, who is the head of JPAL, co-head of JPAL. They actually gave a note in March 2009 to Prime Minister Manmohan Singh on a few big ideas. And I still have that note, and I keep going back to it. And one big idea in that was biometric ID, which we did. The second big idea was universal financial inclusion, which is happening now. And the third idea was education transformation. So in some sense, I think his ideas and his vision has been a great source of inspiration for me and my work. So I'm really grateful to Professor Prahalad for that. Now, today I chose a topic which I thought he would like, which is whether the data explosion gives India a strategic opportunity. Because a big believer in how strategy has to be contextual and how to see it, you know, in what's happening on the ground. So this is the theme of my talk today. Now, what do I mean here? First of all, what has changed in the last 10 years is suddenly the sources of data have gone up dramatically. And a big reason for that is the rise of the smartphone. When you used a simple feature phone, you didn't really generate that much data. But when you use a smartphone, it has so many sensors, it has a GPS chip, accelerometer, a gyrometer, all kinds of things. And suddenly, anyone who's walking out of the phone is actually generating a lot of data. And today, 2.5 billion people in the world have smartphones. And therefore, and we are well on our way to get everybody a smartphone. And even when you look at the recent launch of the Reliance Jio feature phone, it's actually a smartphone masquerading as a feature phone, from what I can make out. It has an operating system, it has all the popular apps, it has an app store, and it's only going to cost 1,500 rupees. So we know that we are in an era where everybody will have already a billion phones in India, but very soon half a billion smartphones will be there in India. So this is one very important reason why data has become so common. The second thing is that the number of devices that generate data beyond phones is also going up, thanks to the fact that we now have intelligent sensors in every device. You have it in a fridge, your washing machine, your automobile, everything has one or more sensors. And if you go back and look at the mainframe era, you had about 40 people to one mainframe. In today's world, you have four devices to one person. That's the shift that is happening. And all this goes under the catchword of Internet of Things, all these devices which are going to get connected. And this is supposed to bring about 50 billion users online. And one of the companies at the center of it is called Arm, which was recently bought by SoftBank. They expect to be selling 1 trillion chips by 2035. And a car has, you know, 500 chips. And as you go to self-driving cars and automation, you're going to have more and more automation of the car. So basically, what you're seeing is a world where everyone and everything will be connected. And each of those connections is going to generate massive amounts of data. So this is a given, that data is going to be a tsunami which is going to come and hit us. Now, what has happened in the last 10, 15 years is that even as we saw the rise of the data, we have seen the rise of platforms that chase data, often chase data over profit. And those platforms are all over the world. In the US, you have great companies like Google, Apple, Amazon, and Facebook, which are called as GAFA. In China, you have Baidu, Alibaba, and Tencent, called as BAT. Even the traditional companies like GE and Siemens are now developing infrastructure to go digital, where every device, every jet engine will be beaming data back. And what's the thing about data is that it not only gives services, it creates the data which is created is owned by these platforms to create more services. And therefore, data is the fuel. Data is the fuel of this new innovation economy. And because if you have the data, you can develop better products. When you develop better products, you get more users. When you get more users, you get more data, and then you develop better products. So there is this virtuous cycle of data which is emerging. And one of the attributes of this world is that it creates what is called as a winner-take-all model, where the guy with the most data wins. And when the guy has all, when an organization has a lot of data, it's very difficult for a new organization to come in and do that, because how do you get millions of people to shift to this new platform? So platforms have this ability to create winner-takes-all. And I'll give you two examples of how this winner-takes-all works. And this is data from Merriam-Webster's Internet Trends. If you look at US digital advertisements, digital advertisements in the US are dominated by two companies. So Google and Facebook together capture 71% of total digital ads, 71%. And incrementally, the incremental growth of digital ads is 89% of it is captured by these two companies. So it's only becoming a bigger and bigger this thing. If you look at China, China has got the world's most advanced mobile payment system. And the Chinese mobile payments do $5.5 trillion worth of payments. This is about 50 times the size of the US. So China is the most advanced payment system. And if you go to China, you walk into any shop, they don't take cash. You take your phone, and you read the QR code, and you debit your WeChat. Now, this is dominated by two companies. One is called Alipay, which is part of the Alibaba group. And the other is called WeChat, which is a very popular messaging app, which is part of the Tencent group. And both these together own 93% of the payment market in China. So what it shows is that when you have a data-based business model, a platform which accumulates data, you just get better and better, and you create this virtuous cycle, which makes it very difficult for other people. Which is why, if you look at what's happening, why is it, people say, why are these companies spending so much money and running up so much losses? It's because their belief is that if you quickly get market share and get a dominant position, then you become a winner-take-all situation. And that's why we see all these huge investments across the world in building platforms. Another example is that when data was first used, it was used to monetize through better advertisements. So when Google and Facebook sold ads, so they could actually use the data to figure out exactly what ad to show whom at what point so that they'll buy something. Or Amazon used data to sell exactly the product you needed. But the big thing in the last 6-7 years is this data has become even more powerful because of the rise and the use of artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence has been an idea which has been going in and out of vogue for decades. But in the last 6 years, it's suddenly taken on dramatic thing because of a concept called deep learning, which allows you to build multi-level neural networks to figure out what is happening. And all the advances we are seeing are because of AI and machine learning and deep learning. And this means that you can enter a market at great speed. Professor Prahalad's, one of his finest contributions was the idea of core competence. If you remember, he talked about the paper called Core Competence of the Corporation, which was one of the most widely read HBR articles many years back. And his point was that companies have competencies, and then they use that core competence to get into adjacent markets. And that's how they build the thing. Data is core competence on steroids. Because companies that have data can very quickly get into adjacent markets, including automobiles. I'll come to that, Vikram. Let's look what happened in the US and China. Netflix is becoming, you buy Netflix and watch shows. 10 years back, Netflix was a company which stuffed a DVD into a FedEx envelope and sent it to your house. 10 years back, in 2007, the same year that Apple launched the iPhone, Netflix launched video streaming and began the whole idea of getting on-demand, you know, things that you want. Now, up till 2013, Netflix was just a distributor of content from other people. So you watched a movie, but the movie was actually made by some other channel or by some other studio. In 2013, Netflix entered the content business because now they had the customers. Today, Netflix has 100 million customers. And more importantly, they had the data of the behavior of those customers. Who liked romantic comedies, who liked, you know, thrillers, who liked violent movies, who liked, you know, George Clooney, whatever. They had all this data with them. And they were able to start getting into the content business of creating shows. And the first show they created is House of Cards. And one of the reasons is they found that people liked Kevin Spacey. I mean, they did a lot of research. And House of Cards was the first television show made for the internet to win an Emmy Award. And this year, they have 126 series of films, and that, you know, the very, very popular shows, Narcos, and, you know, Master of Nothing. I'm sure all of you guys are there doing binge watching on Netflix. This year, they won 93 Emmys. A company which had not produced a single show 4 years back has won 93 Emmys compared to HBO, which is the father of fine television with Sopranos to Game of Thrones. HBO won 110, so they're already catching up with HBO in 4 years. This is the power of how they can do with data. Similarly, Alibaba launched a money market mutual fund called Yaobao, which means leftover treasure, which is they would, because a lot of people left small amounts of money in their Alipay account, and they could figure out the behavior of their consumption. They convinced them that when that money is idling, why don't you sweep it into a money market account where we'll give you a rate of interest, which was probably higher than what the banks gave. And this has reached $165 billion in 4 years. So both these were launched 4 years back. So it shows that in this new world of data, the data combined with AI and machine learning and all these things, businesses can be built very rapidly and at scale, which can be extremely threatening and disruptive to incumbents in that space. So data is a new kind of resource. Just like oil was the resource that dominated the 20th century, data is the resource that dominates the 21st century. Now, data is actually, unlike oil, oil is a non-renewable resource, and, you know, if you own the oil, then somebody else cannot get the oil. Data is unlimited. The more data you have, the more devices you have, the more data is generated. It's also non-rivalrous. That means even if multiple people own the data, it doesn't lose in value. So you can, you know, data can be shared. But the reality is the data is not shared because data becomes a source of strategic advantage. So what has happened is that the data producers who have social platforms, commerce platforms, location-based services, search engines, have become data consumers, which is why a Google is able to get into self-driving cars. And Amazon is able to offer Amazon fulfillment where any retailer can be on their platform. The Netflix can go from being a distributor to a content creator. And, you know, an Apple can have a Siri answering questions, or you can have an Alexa Echo bot in your room, which will play exactly the music that you want. So suddenly, this is what I meant by saying that this is core competence on steroids. It's using the data you have to move into adjacencies. Now you'll ask, what is Google got to do with self-driving cars? The fact of the matter is that Google has built the world's best maps, Google Maps. Everybody, 1 billion people use Google Maps on their Android phones. They have mapped all the things on the world using Street View. So they have actually gone around with cameras and videos and filmed every object. then they're able to apply machine learning to figure out exactly what is where on the world. And then they have used image recognition so that the automobile can recognize whether it's another car or is a pedestrian or a dog. And combining all that, they're able to come up with the technology for self-driving cars. So think about it. A company which has a search engine with advertising revenue is going to make self-driving cars. And this goes on and on. So fundamentally, core competence on steroids happens using data, and which is why you see why the whole world is saying, what's going to happen next? So what you're saying is platforms that accumulate user data rapidly disrupt industries and outgrow competition and create silos. They create market dominant forces, and we're calling this data domination. And we need to be aware of this strategic trend which is happening. The world is just waking up to the problem. Basically, today, around the world, governments are waking up to what does this mean? And there are broadly three different strains of thought. First, what does it mean for privacy? And even in India, we are having a big debate on privacy, where there's a fundamental right. The government has created a body now to set up a data protection law. So there's a whole privacy dimension. The second is, what does it mean in terms of competition? Because the first requirement of competition is that when a new player comes into a market, he should be able to attract customers from the old player. That's how you keep the old players on, you know, on their toes. But if there's no way for the new guy to come in because all the data is with the old guy, then there's no way that you have competition. Now, unfortunately, antitrust laws in the world were designed for a 20th century economy. So antitrust in the world was about consumer welfare and prices. But in a data world, you give everything free because you are the product, your data is the product, so why, you know, you give it free. So there's no question of prices going up, and people are happy with the services, so there's no issue. So, but we have to think differently about competition in this new world, because how do newcomers come? How does the new social media platform come? How does the new messaging platform come? How will they even get customers? Because everybody is locked into the old platforms. And the third thing is what we call as data colonization, which is that if all your data is vacuumed up and kept somewhere else, then in the long run, you're going to lose. Now, fortunately, India is rapidly going digital thanks to the program of financial inclusion, 290 million bank accounts, over 1 billion Aadhaars, 350 million smartphones, 1 billion phones. So we see that there is a massive push on digital happening in India. And we're also seeing that when Indians have digital access, which is safe, secure, and convenient, they very rapidly switch to these platforms. For example, more and more documents now are being signed electronically online, 21 million in the last 2 years, more than today, the Aadhaar system does almost 1 billion authentications a month and several hundred million eKYC, so you can open a bank account, get a SIM card. There are more than 500 million bank accounts linked to Aadhaar, so that India runs now the world's largest DBT, which has done about 2 billion transactions where money is deposited into people's accounts. So India has been adopting all this very rapidly at scale. And what this means that India will go from data poor to data rich very quickly. Because the combination of the fact that more people use smartphones, the combination of the fact that more devices have sensors, and the combination of the fact that more and more Indian systems will be digital and online. Like if everybody goes cashless, suddenly you become data rich because there's the behavior of your spending is there. So India will go from data poor to data rich in 3 years. But we need to think, and this is where Professor Prahalad's ideas are so important. What is the strategic implication of this? If India is going to become data poor to data rich so quickly, if data is the new oil, if there is an issue that data domination happens because of winner take all things, what is the right policies? What is the right strategy that a country should adopt for this new resource of the 21st century? It's a very, very important strategic question that we need to think about. And we're running out of time because you need to get this done fast before you get dominated and you know the whole thing goes out. Because I think this is happening at a speed that people have not fully absorbed, and it's going to happen even faster. So India needs to take a strategic view of data. How is data to be deployed? How is data to be used for the public good? This is a very important conversation. And we think there are three things that are impacted. Data colonization, which is that people have, the data is not given away. Privacy and this winner take all. How do you have competition? And it's important to realize that this is not a technology issue. It's a policy issue. Of course, it's a policy issue caused by technology because everybody has a smartphone. But it's very much a policy issue because next 100 years will be decided by who has the data and how it's used. So the solution we have is what we call as inverting the data. Inverting the data, which means, what is invert the data? Invert the data means, instead of data being used to sell to you, you can continue doing that. Is there a way you can think of data being used to empower the owner and creator of the data? So if my data is, I'm creating a lot of data because I use a phone or because I drive a car which shows where I am. Is there a way to harness that data for my own use? And that's what we mean by inverting the data. So data to be used to empower the user. That's what we mean by data inversion. In other words, put the user at the center of the equation. So there could be multiple data producers. The UPI gives you cashless payments. The GST gives you taxes that you pay. The Bharat bill payment system gives you the bills that you're paying. Search says what you're looking for. Is there a way that the user can use his data to get credit or improve his skills or you know help in content or whatever? So is there a way to rethink the model where the user is at the heart of his own data and is empowered? That's really the conceptual thing that we are saying. And remember, when we talk about inversion, this is not protectionism. We're not saying stop other companies from coming. It continues to be a free market where everybody operates on a level playing field, both foreign and domestic. And they continue to collect data because their business model depends on data. But ultimately, the data should be available to the creator of the data to use for his empowerment. That is what is required. That has to be done through laws and so forth. So inversion of data is very important. And inversion is about choice and freedom so that customers can choose multiple providers and the freedom to share the data. Now, why invert the data? Of course, this cartoon says very clearly, we don't trust anybody. We don't trust government. We don't trust companies. We don't give, the best thing is to give the data back to the person. But it also makes sure that it prevents colonization because now I can use my data and combine it with machine learning and et cetera to get some benefit. So that is a form of empowerment. It helps in privacy because I don't get locked in. If I'm unhappy with a particular service provider, if I'm unhappy with the terms and conditions, I can go to somebody else. And therefore, you can negotiate your own terms. Today, you can't negotiate your own terms. It's take it or leave it. You want to come on my platform? Say, I agree to all my terms. And it also enables competition, because once I have portability of data, then I can go to a new provider with my address book or my social graph or whatever and start operating. So I'm not locked in. So it makes all these things possible by putting the user at the center of his data. Now, who benefits if we invert the data, right? Now, it's important, and this is again, I think, going back to Professor Prahalad's thinking. He always would ask you to go back to first principles and say, what is the situation? When the West implemented the internet technology and all these companies came up, they were economically rich before they were data rich. If you think of the data revolution as about 15 years old, then already these countries were well off. Already their per capita incomes were $40,000 or whatever. So the business models that emerged where people came up with models to substitute existing ways of doing business with the new way. So already the US was spending $500 billion on advertising through television and newspapers and all that. So what the new companies did was took some of that advertising revenue and brought it to the digital world. So it's not new revenue, it's revenue that moved from from online. Similarly, today online retail in the US is about 10%, Amazon is about 6%. But a lot of that was sales that were happening through the physical channels, through Nordstrom or Saks Fifth Avenue or Neiman Marcus or Sears or whatever, and brought it to online sales. So they really, because the advertising revenue was so large, they could actually target people, move the ads, and do a better job with data. That's how the business model was. But India is not an economically rich country, but it's a data-rich country. So think about this. What does it mean if a country is data-rich before it is economically rich? The business model of advertising will not work because India, for all its size, the total expenditure on advertising is about $10 billion. It's about 60,000 crores. So how much money are you going to make digitally from advertising? It's not going to be much. But India has the advantage that if people have data, then can we have business models where people can use their data for their future? So an example of that is credit. Why is it that Indians don't get credit? They don't get loans. You know, all the loans go to big guys who then disappear to wherever. Why is it that the common man is not getting credit? Because the lender does not have enough data about that person. He has no details. This is what economists call as knowledge asymmetry. So knowledge asymmetry means that you don't get loans. And therefore, our loans are limited to a very small fraction of our system. So how will that change in this data world? Let's say we have a shopkeeper who's now has, he earlier he was completely using cash and paper. Tomorrow he becomes a part of the GST system. He starts using UPI for making his payments. He starts paying his bills on the bill payment system. All these things generate data. So if I look at his GST, I can see the value of his sales. And that is certified by GST. Similarly, my bill payment is certifying saying how much bills I paid. All these things create what we call as a digital footprint. So the small business creates a digital footprint. And if you invert the data and empower this small business, he can then say, give me my data, and I will give it to a bank or an NBFC. And this is authenticated, trusted data which shows my business performance. And then that bank or NBFC says, yes, I see that this guy has a monthly sale of 2 lakhs, he's regular, he pays his bills on time, he deserves a loan. And suddenly, using his footprint, he's able to get a loan, and using that loan, he's able to drive business growth. Using that business growth, he generates more data, which makes him get a better loan. So you can create a virtuous flywheel of credit using data. It's very important. Similarly, you can do the same for skills. For example, this is again an area where Professor Prahalad and I worked together on the National Skills Prime Minister's Council. The big problem here is again knowledge asymmetry. I have no way of knowing whether the guy is a master carpenter or a trainee carpenter, so I pay all carpenters the same. But if you can create a registry where a carpenter has the record of his work, then as he becomes a better carpenter, as he gets more skills, as he does a better job, then he can get a better wage for his work. And therefore, you can actually create a differentiation using information. So skills is another area where knowledge asymmetry can be changed using all these things. So fundamentally, the way to think about it is, if you invert data and put the data in the hands of the person or the small business, and if you're able to leverage the idea that India is going to be data rich before it's economically rich, We use data to eliminate knowledge asymmetry in various activities, in healthcare, in financial services, in skills, and jobs. And that's how we will drive this change, where data will be the engine of improvement of economy. So data is not an engine for you to buy something, but data is an engine for you to get a better life. And this is the power of what is possible, and this is what we need strategically. So how do we, okay, oh, it's nice talking, how do we invert the data and all that? Fortunately, India has unique digital infrastructure to invert the data. The first is what is called as the India stack. 1 billion people have Aadhaar, they can do a KYC, they can sign the document, they can store it digitally, they can use the unified payment interface or the Bheem application to make payments. All this has a dramatic ability to lower costs and create digital footprints for 1 billion Indians. At the same time, India is building some very large national platform business. The GSTN, which has just gone live, has 8 million businesses filing an average of 120 invoice line items per month, which is 1 billion line items per month. The FASTag system, which is the tolling system, which was designed 7 years back, allows a truck to drive through a highway and automatically debit his bank account. Already that system is doing 7 million transactions a month, and approximately 10 to 15% of transactions on the highways today are done using FASTag, and the government plans to make it universal. When you combine the GSTN with the FASTag, you can have a tag for the truck which also has the electronic e-bill which contains the goods on the truck. So you don't need to stop a truck. You can just read electronically and you know what, and you can do only inspection of 2% of the trucks or whatever. So you can dramatically change the logistics of this country. Similarly, the Bharat bill payment will have billions of invoices, electricity bills, water bills, telephone bills, and that generates a lot of data. So India is simultaneously creating a technology stack for consumers and building these large national platforms, both of which have huge data implications. And also India has the world's only authentication infrastructure, because when you go digital, the challenge is how do you make sure the person is the person they claim to be? And that's why we have this thing called two-factor authentication. You have to give two factors, your card, debit card, and your password to make a financial transaction. But India has the ability where everybody has a mobile phone, so the mobile phone becomes one factor of authentication. You can use the bank PIN, which can become another factor, or you can use an Aadhaar biometric authentication. All these are available as national authentication platforms, which means you can digitally create a way of ensuring on any device that the person is the person he claims to be by combining these factors. It's a bit technical, but this infrastructure of being able to verify safely and securely the identity of a person is only in India. Only India has this deep technology for this. So all the pieces are in place. And therefore, India is in a unique place to actually implement inversion of data. Because to invert data, I need to have a way for 1 billion people and 50 million businesses to get data in small amounts in real time. Otherwise, this is not going to work. And therefore, there's a whole infrastructure where I can get data and give it to my lender, etc. And therefore, this is how inversion is possible. So our view is that data is empowering when it is in the hands of the people. If people own the data, it's like just like democracy is empowering because the vote is with the people, data is empowering when the data is with the people. And that's, we must therefore invert and create freedom and choice. And that's why we call this as data democracy. That just like democracy gives people the right to vote and select who runs the country, data democracy gives people the right to their own data so they can do whatever they want with it and improve their lives. This is a very fundamental shift in strategic thinking. The other thing is that all this data also means we now have a real-time way of looking at the economy. Today, how does it work? We collect some statistics after some few months, something comes out that the GDP grew at so much, somebody else says, I don't agree with you, all that stuff happens. So it's a very old-fashioned way of doing things. But now we have a real-time system. Because if the GSTN is processing 1 billion invoices a month, You have the location of where that business happened. You know the product code of what happened. You can say in real time that last month, the sale of cold steel rolls in Chandigarh went up by 2% using data. So instead of depending on some survey and arguments, you have real-time data on the economy. When you look at the movement of trucks, you have real-time data on the truck movements. So you'll exactly know what's the logistical situation, what's moving on the ground. When you look at the NPCI's data, you know real-time how much is becoming cashless, because you know all the cash. So we have to rethink a model of managing, not by doing surveys where the results come after months and years, but have a real-time system of managing. Because we now have the systems in place, we just have to build the insights from all the data that this is going to create. So what does it mean? So we have talked about making India a data democracy. What does it mean in reality? There are really three simple things we have to do, and none of them involve spending money. The good news is this is not a budget. This is only intellectual. First is, government should unlock public data so that people have access to their own data. And government has already begun this process. For example, all the driver's licenses are already in the digital locker, and you can access your driver's license on your smartphone with the right authorization. GSTN will give me all the data about my indirect taxes. The income tax department is already giving me my TDS returns electronically. So you have to extend that to every part of the government, where government publishes data so people get it back very easily. This is nothing but a decision. It's an executive decision of the government. The second thing is the same thing needs to happen in regulated markets. So we have basically five major regulated markets. RBI regulates banking, SEBI regulates capital markets, IRDA regulates insurance, PFRDA regulates pensions, and TRAI regulates telecom. In these five markets, the regulators can now say that market participants must publish data at the request of the consumer. So if I want a bank statement from my bank, I should be able to get it digitally signed from my bank. If I want a mutual fund statement from my mutual fund, and this is all done by regulation. Regulation provides for that. And we're not saying share it with somebody else. Share it just with the person whose data it is. So that's his data. This again requires just regulations by the regulator. But what do we do with organizations that are neither government nor regulated? And for that, you need a law. And therefore, you need to have a law. And hopefully, the current group, which is looking at the data protection law under Justice Sri Krishna, we'll also look at this empowerment aspect of data, because data protection is about how do you make sure that governments and companies don't misuse your data. It's a defensive argument. This is an argument saying how do individuals use their data for their future. So that has to be part of this law, which allows me to use my health records to get better healthcare, use my business records to get better loans, use my education records to get better jobs, and this requires a law. So what is required is really governments opening up their data to individuals and businesses, regulators doing the same for entities under the regulation, and the government doing a law for all other market participants. That's all. This is nothing to do with spending money. It's to do with thinking through an architecture for opening up data. And we think that best way to check power is to distribute, not accumulate it. This is what Mr. Ram Guha will agree. India in 1947 was a very bold decision, saying everybody gets the vote. That was a major decision because they didn't say, oh, we'll only give educated everybody. But they did that because they said, if we give power to the people, that's the only way we can check another colonization. Similarly, we have to put data with the people and then let them use that. And that, I think, is something that we need to do. And this is a strategic thing. This is something which can be done. It doesn't involve money. It just requires thinking out all the things. And I think this is the kind of thing that Professor Prahalad would have liked to do. Thank you very much.
Nandan, thank you very much. That was,
I did say, right, I mean, you know, that was visionary, that was combining technology with social purpose, and that was great communication. Thank you very much. I'm going to start by asking a question, and then we'll collect about three or four questions and maybe do them in groups. So let me start with a question on, you use the phrase that's been used a couple of times, which is the data is the new oil. You know, there is this concern over monopolies, and you showed some striking data on concentration in the US and concentration in China, on payments in China, and on advertising revenues in the US. About 100 years ago, the US actually, at the start of its own antitrust legislation, brought in rules that, for example, broke up Standard Oil, and it specifically targeted oil. It says oil is so essential for the economy that it can't be, you can't have this concentrated ownership. So they actually broke up Standard Oil, which was the heart of the Rockefeller fortune and so on, as a way of trying to ensure that, you know, you had ongoing innovation and productivity growth and so on, and not capture of monopoly rents. They did the same thing in the US with the breakup of AT&T around 1980, maybe, you know, to again break up voice calls and so on. Do you see things going the same way with the likes of Alphabet and Facebook and Baidu and Tencent, you know, where they'll actually need to be the government coming in and using antitrust regulations to actually break them up to move away from a monopoly situation?
Well, you see, as you rightly said, the Sherman Antitrust Act was passed in 1911 for Standard Oil, and then there have been several big cases, the most prominent being AT&T and then the Microsoft decree in this thing. So the thing is, part of the issue is that the antitrust thinking is still a 20th century world thinking. It talks about price, you know, you use prices and gouge out your consumers, and you know, you have control of assets and so on, physical assets. But this data world and the implications of antitrust are not well understood. In fact, there's no body of work. Actually, the best paper on this is a paper by a 28-year-old young girl of Pakistani origin called Lina Khan on the Yale Law Journal on antitrust in the new world of, it's a brilliant article by young girl of Pakistani origin. And so I think the body of thinking on what does antitrust mean in a data world is not understood. However, I think globally there is some activity. I mean, the European commissions have been very active, and they've been fining these companies on competition issues. Japan has just announced a policy for antitrust. So there's a thing. The US has been, for the last 15 years after the Microsoft deal, has not really been active on this front, but we'll have to see what happens. China is a different thing. I mean, China basically enabled these big companies to emerge. And how they deal with that, they have to decide. But you can sense, for example, there was a proposal earlier that these platforms could lend and could become credit rating agencies using their own data. But I sense now a slight pushback on that. So I think there's some awareness happening that you're creating these big guys.
Thank you. So I've got lots of questions, but I don't want to monopolize you. So so we'll collect three or four questions in front. And only one rule of the house, which is it has to be a question, please. Comments we'll do at lunch.
I just want to find out, what is the initiative you have done for ensuring data security? This is primarily in view of UID, which you planned to be one of the robust systems, but today it is leaked.
No, it's not leaked. Let me correct that. Yeah.
We'll come to. We'll take three or four questions. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah, one at the back there. Straight back. Yeah. If you've got the mic, you go first.
Yeah.
Then.
Within recent Supreme Court directive that information privacy is not the really absolute right, and we saying that when data inverting. is the right option of, what is it, giving the data in the hands of the people. Will these two things will not, what is it?
What are the questions?
The question was like this. The recent Supreme Court judgment saying that when information privacy is not an absolute right to the citizens, that was, I think the judgment is pending, but they just said that one during the one of the judgments. It's not judgment during one of the rulings, but now if we say this data inverting, which is clearly about giving the data in the hands of a what to say, a normal citizen, well, these two things will
sure.
not.
Yeah. Okay.
And then okay. Last one in this round, and then we'll come back.
My question is the data reversion, correct? We are giving back the data to the common person. But the step of educating the common person that this data is available for me and I can use it, I feel that step is...
Sure. No, absolutely. No, first of all, let me say that on the privacy thing, the currently the Supreme Court had a 9-judge bench which finished its deliberations or its submissions by the petitioners and respondents last week. And the court has yet to come out with a judgment on that, and that hopefully will come out before August 27th when the current Chief Justice retires. So we have to wait and see what is the view that the court takes on the issue of whether privacy is a fundamental right or not. That is the debate. It's a very arcane constitutional debate about fundamental right to privacy. After that, the court will then have a bench on the Aadhaar case. So right now it's a level higher. Conceptually, whether we have a fundamental right to privacy. And the privacy issue, as I said, is about how do you ensure that governments and companies don't misuse your data? That is the privacy issue. What we are saying is very different, is that that has to be handled, but beyond that, how do you ensure that people use their own data for their future? And that's, so it's like more about empowerment of people's data as opposed to protecting people, which also has to be done, but this is about empowering them. I think I agree with you that the learning, there's a whole issue of how to educate people about the power of the data, but I think the GST has given us a great opportunity. The GST, as I said, has 8 million businesses filing 1 billion invoices, line items a month. And if we can get these 8 million businesses to start using their GST and data to get credit from the financial system, immediately they'll see the power of their own data because they'll be able to get their invoice details from GST, give it to the bank, get a loan. So we have to build some signaling big use cases so that more consumers and businesses start appreciating that data is so powerful. On the security thing, there's really been no hack to the Aadhaar system. People have tried to get people to do a OTP and give their details and capture, take an A. So it's not really a hack, but absolutely security is going to be a big concern in all these things. If you're going to be an increasingly digital world, we have to make sure that all our systems are secure. That's an ongoing thing. In all over the world, this is a challenge. And we also have to, and we're moving at a very rapid pace, so we'll do it very quickly. Agreed.
Thanks. You take one in front here, and then a lady on the side here. Thanks, yeah. Just here.
Thank you. I come from a healthcare background. So my question to you is, data is only as useful as its source and veracity, and the way it's analyzed and used, especially in healthcare. So how would you ensure that those two aspects are met, the veracity of the data, authenticity, and how it's analyzed for then future use?
Okay. Lady on the right here.
Yeah, excellent vision about data democracy. But isn't the foundation of this data democracy going to lie in the digital infrastructure, the data centers, the networking? And that requires massive investments and us to leapfrog in technology and to the new technologies of whatever is called 5G and cloud and all that. So what are your thoughts on that? Are we really geared up for that?
I'll just take it these two.
Just take these two.
Yeah,
sure.
First of all, to your question, if you look at the architecture of this India stack, data comes from the root source. So, for example, your degree certificates will come from the university.
The GST and tax details will come from the GST authority. The TDS returns will come from the income tax authority. The bank statement comes from the bank. And that is digitally signed and encrypted by the source. So when I get a bank statement and I pass it on to another bank to do a lending decisions, they know on a non-repudiable basis that that has actually come from this source. So the whole architecture is designed, it's encrypted and signed. So there's a lot of stuff there for the veracity. On the other question, I think that's not a challenge really today. For example, cloud technology has become quite common. We have a lot of open source platforms. If you look at Aadhaar, for example, the whole thing is a massive cloud, private cloud, which does 1 billion transactions a month. And I think we have many examples now in India of these kind of national, and they're not expensive to build, because a lot of the source is open source. A lot of the hardware is commodity hardware. So the know-how exists, and many of these systems are built on that basis. They're actually, that's the easy part of this. You know, the cost is very little compared to the benefits we get.
Thanks. We'll take two questions, one right in front. Thanks.
Nandan, when we talk of democracy, casting a vote is at one level. And at another level, it's about the freedom to form a collective.
Freedom to?
Form a collective, right? So drawing a parallel to data democracy, and you mentioned three steps, should there be a provision for the data, the individuals or citizens, to form a collective in a data environment? Should that be form a part of the policy is the question.
Okay, and then one back there. Gentleman in the blue shirt, yes.
See, you have been talking a lot about data. What about data security? Because the entire hardware is on Chinese machines, and every day we are fighting with China. Whether it's the telecom handsets, the telecom digital switching equipment, the storage equipment, the Apple phones, everything is from China. What? How are we taking guard about it?
He's afraid his payments data will wind up at Doklam.
This must be Republic TV or something. Anyway, just a joke. I think first of all, I think the collective is a very interesting idea. That how do people collect together and get a collective benefit of the data they have is, I must admit, I had not thought about it, but I think it's a good idea to mull over. On the infrastructure side, I think my own inclination is that we need to use more and more open source technology and commodity hardware for many of these things. Because that open source code is visible, you can read it, you know exactly if there's anything in it. And commodity hardware is available from all around the world. So I think we have to, in fact, the government now actually has an open source policy for building systems.
You know, I have a privacy question, which is, I've heard this view expressed that we're now in a world where privacy is an obsolete concept, and that one has to move beyond privacy to rights instead, so that even if your privacy is violated and people, you don't have that privacy, everyone knows everything about you, that doesn't change how you live, that doesn't imperil your security, that doesn't imperil your ability to live in a particular way. I mean, if I picked a facetious example, the fact that I'm a beef eater maybe should not need to be concealed, but can be as long as I have the right to eat beef. No. So it's you combine a privacy issue, you deal with a privacy issue with a rights.
No, I think privacy is a very, very complicated topic. In fact, you could see that in the Supreme Court discussion. They planned for one day, it went on for 6 days because there's so many nuances. I think digitization is making a dramatic impact on that, because the more you use digital products, the more you leave digital footprints. The more you leave digital footprints, the more possibility that somebody can, you know, figure out something about you. I mean, you go to a restaurant and order a beef stroganoff, and it comes on your debit card bill, then the debit card guy knows that you ate beef, so that kind of stuff. So I think that,
exactly.
So that kind of risk is there. And there's no clear answers on this. I mean, the, for example, today the most advanced protection is in the Europe, which is coming out with their general data protection rules next year, and the UK is now implementing similar things. Then the other problem is, how do we have consent? You know, because there's something called consent fatigue. Every 5 minutes, if I'm saying, do you want to do this, do you want to, you know, nothing's left. So a lot of people, like there's a very good lawyer in Bangalore called Rahul Matan, who say that consent is actually is no longer viable because of the scale of the operation. And that the best way to implement privacy is by putting strong compliance measures on companies and governments that they don't misuse the data. So they, it's a very, very contentious, very complex field, and there are no easy answers.
Because, you know, I have this thing where, you know, when you use Apple or you go to the iStore or anything like that, it gives you this 40-page document says, you know, do you
I've yet to meet
this,
a single person who's read the terms and agreements
of
any electronic product.
And you get it once a month, you know, I mean, or each time it keeps being upgraded. So you'd have to, if you read it once, you'd have to read it almost every day, so there's no chance. No one's challenged it. I mean, no one's taken Apple to court saying, hey, listen, this is actually a violation of rights, even though you're asking for consent.
No, that's why
this is actually one of the aspects,
that's why that data protection law becomes important. One of the aspects of the data protection law will be regulation of how terms and conditions are set. Today there is nothing, no?
Exactly. You take a couple more? One here. Man in the white shirt, yes. Yeah, you need a bike. They'll bring you a bike. Sorry, the lady first, since you've got the mic in your hand, and then the gentleman in the white shirt.
My question is on the right to be forgotten.
Huh?
Is this the right to be forgotten? Is this something you would personally approve of? And even, for example, murderers after 14 years, they're supposed to be given a new life. So would you support something where we could delete our digital footprint after, say, 14 years or something and restart?
Yeah. I mean, the right to be forgotten is a thing. It's there in the GDPR. The European rules coming next year have a right to be, and even the new UK rules propose that. So that's again, I mean, I think it's again, you have to decide that as a policy, but it's a good idea to have that, because you should be able to erase your records in a Google search or whatever.
Okay. Gentleman in the white shirt, and then Rajan, and then the last question to Tarun.
Yeah, my question is, I just want to know, when somebody is collecting some of my data, analyzing those data, why don't in the data inversion model, they have to write down in some page that this is the data being collected about me, this is the analytic collected about me, and regulators define what I can reset and what can be shared with whom. That at least that basic information should be present on any website to see that what is being collected about me.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
Then only I know where I can get what data I have to get from inversion model.
Actually, Google has that. You go to my activities on Google, it'll tell you what all you've been doing on Google.
Okay, you might be shocked. Yeah. Sorry, Rajan, would you like to question? Yeah.
Thanks, Nandan, for a wonderful presentation. And, you know, just, you know, again, keeping CK, you know, a little there and just thinking how he would have thought. You know, there was a time we talked of democratization of information, right? I mean, you know, and suddenly the exposure to a person just went, you know, a lot further than what they knew. Then, you know, it was democratization of intelligence, which is really the world today. And I think with democratization of data, don't you think that somewhere, you know, when you have so much information about a person, you start putting that person into that silo. So the call to action from that person just increases in that limited world. You know, so if I know that you like cars and you like this, everything that I'm going to see, and today, you know, in a digital world, I spend so much time on that, and especially I'm talking more for the younger generation. Don't you think this, you're going to get typecast into what you think. You're going to just see so much more of it. And that can actually be taken advantage of course, by companies and corporates to, you know, influence by politicians and others to kind of influence thought process. How do we address that challenge? You know, how do we address that challenge?
No, it's a very burning issue. These are what are called as filter bubbles. So the machine learning algorithms filter the news and things or adds to what you like. And you combine that with fake news in your filter bubble. Then, you know, so a lot of the political polarization happening is believed to be because people are in these social media silos and in these filter bubbles. And you see this on Twitter and so on. So I think this is a very big issue around the world, that you tend to then remain with people of your type, or you only read views of what you like. And even if the fake news is fake, because it's news you like, you still take it. And all this.
Then you act accordingly, you know.
So it's a big issue that the world is facing.
You know, before I give the last question to Tarun, I'm going to over-exploit my moderator's privilege to ask you my last question.
Abuse of power.
Abuse of power. abuse of monopoly power at the mic. So the last year at the when I had the privilege of giving the fifth CK Prahalad lecture. I spoke about technology in Indian industry, and I made this strong argument that Indian industry needs to invest a lot more in technology. And I gave in R&D specifically, and I gave the example of the Indian IT services business, which on average, the top 10 companies in India invest 1% of turnover in R&D. The top 10 IT services businesses invest 8% of turnover. Chinese companies invest 8% in R&D. And if you look at what your presentation throws up, also potentially huge business opportunities for companies that can come up with service offerings built around mining some of this data in a very unique way. Do you see our major IT services businesses being players in this? Because they know how to help the world do a better job with this, but they don't seem to be investing in developing their own solutions. I mean, you know, it's become fashionable to give advice to past companies that one founded. So you may as well.
That's right. I don't do that.
Join.
I never give advice like that. So no, but I think this challenge of data is, I think, has huge impacts. Obviously. One is IT services companies, but I think it has a big challenge fundamentally to industry, even to the businesses. I mean, why is GE investing so much in Predix, which is their IoT cloud? Because what is happening is, for a long time, companies had barriers of entry because of their size, their distribution, their products, their scale, and their domain knowledge. All those are now if data combined with machine learning can figure out how an industry works. I don't need domain knowledge. I'll do it with automation. So why is it that these guys believe that they can make cars? Because they're going to pump billions of data points and figure out how to make the car drive better. So this is a huge challenge for IT services companies, and it's a huge challenge for incumbent players, even very large players in all industries.
Yeah, maybe we have to mess up some people's minds in terms of saying, what are you doing? What are you doing? Some shareholder activism.
Sure.
Okay, last question for Tarun.
Thanks, Naushad. I just want to take a couple of minutes to go down memory lane and then come to Nandan with a question, which he will not like.
She will not?
She will not like.
Come on, yeah. Some difficult question. I thought you were a friend.
Yeah, as a friend, we need to ask that question so that everybody can hear your answer. You know, CK gave us many things. He gave us aspiration. He gave us self-confidence. He gave us belief that we could be competitive. He taught us about the bottom of the pyramid, that there is a market. And he talked about skills, which you have referred to. He made the private sector believe in itself and in entrepreneurship, that it could make a difference, that it was not only about government. And in our early days, when we used to go to the US with missions, he helped us to connect to US companies to invest in India. And all through the decades of association, one person was constantly there for all his presentations, this lady who is sitting next to me, Mrs. Gayatri Prahalad. I think he would never speak, and she was not there. You know, it's quite amazing. And I've never seen this, and I just wanted to recall this for to share with everybody here. And this lecture goes around the country. So we are in Bangalore after several years. We may not come back to Bangalore again unless we ask Nandan to do the next memorial lecture also. And he brings us another topic to talk about. So there were two things that we did in those days, because we were getting so much from CK. We decided that there would be a minder for him.
A what?
A minder.
A minder.
In American terminology, a minder. Because he was all over the country, dealing with the CII at central level, regional level, state level, you know. And we are a very messy organization, as you must have found out, Naushan. So we appointed a minder who was in the same or similar time zone in Washington, Kiran Pasricha. And everything had to go through that neck of the bottle, you know, and then it was coordinated through. So that CK's experience in India would be smooth. You know? There were failures, there were problems, but by and large, that was the minder for many, many years. And CK, who obviously saw the future better than most, on his last visit to Washington, just before he fell ill and he passed away, he called Kiran for dinner on a Sunday evening. So it only CK could drag this person from her suburb to Washington, D.C. for dinner, and gave her a pearl necklace, which you must have given to him to give to her, in appreciation of decades of minding him. He was fine, he was fit. It was within a week that he fell ill. But this is something I wanted to mention, that we had to have a minder, because this amazing man brought so much to us and to India that we didn't want to mess it up with, you know, everybody trying to connect with him. And there were, of course, turf issues in CII over that. But it worked well for us. Now, I mentioned that CII handled him like that. But what he brought, this looking into the future, is what this man brings to us. They both of them have this something in common, that they see the future and they bring the future to us. The two public intersections between CK and Nandan that I know of, public, private, there would have been many, is India everywhere at Davos, led by Nandan. The biggest, most significant presentation of India, projection of India in Davos to the whole business community, funded by the corporate sector. And I remember CK coming at the end of the India reception by CII and saying he never felt so proud of India as he felt at that moment. And this man led us at that time. He was our captain. The other public intersection was 2007, New York. Under Nandan's leadership, more than $1 million was raised from the corporate sector to do a week in New York on India at 60. It was 2007, India's 60th birthday. And we had Chidambaram, and we had Montek, and we had Kamal Nath, and others, very eminent speakers right through the week. But there was one conference with a keynote speech by C.K. Prahalad. And he went to the lectern when his time came to speak after the introductions. And he said, ladies and gentlemen, India in 60 is done. Forget it. Let's talk about India at 75. And that's how the vision, the dream of 2022 came on that day in New York from him. And he fleshed it out, made a PowerPoint presentation. He said, this is the kind of India that we want. And after that, it was Rajan Navani, who is here, who shadowed him right through, worked with him, got all that input, which Chandrajit Banerjee has referred to, and then implemented the India at 75 program across the country. And he's done it for 10 years consistently, day in, day out, night in, night out, 24/7. I think Rajan Navani needs a big hand. And today the Prime Minister is talking because he was one of those to whom CK and Rajan and others made presentations in Gujarat when he was Chief Minister about India at 75. And he's talking about the new India and it's 2022. And he has all the inputs from the system on what CK's vision was. And you know, and of course, he's taking it to a different level, as I think he's taken Aadhaar. I mean, it shows that he while others around him may be hesitant about Aadhaar or this or that, but he can grab onto a idea and he can take it to a new level, which is great. So Nandan, tell us something about yourself. This is my question. What kind of a guy were you when you were young? What kind of a child were you? What kind of a family did you come up in? You see, I believe that ordinary people are capable of doing extraordinary things, given the space, given the opportunity. So were you an extraordinary kid, or were you an ordinary kid?
Ordinary.
Why?
He has to say more than that, right?
Yeah, he has to say much more than that. He has to answer this question properly. You now have to give us at least 5 minutes.
Not 5 minutes.
On yourself. What kind of background did you have? Tell us about your parents. Tell us about your family. You have siblings, or you're an only child like me. You know, we want to know a bit about you. Who is this Nandan Nilekani beyond the public figure? That's the question
that I didn't want to answer. No, I think it's a fair question. I think, I was born in Bangalore, so I'm a native Bangalorean. My father was a middle class mill manager in a textile mill in Bangalore. And I was here till the age of 12. I went to a school, Bishop Cotton. And then that company got into difficulties, so he had to move on. And he realized that his job was not going to be secure, so he asked me to stay with my uncle in a town called Dharwad, which is a small town halfway between here and Bombay. So in some sense, I think the fact that at the age of 12, I was living with my uncle away from my parents gave me a lot of independence, in the sense I learned to become self-sufficient, I guess, at a fairly young age. And I had a very good environment, and my father was a socialist. He was a Nehruvian follower. My uncle was what's called as a radical humanist. He was part of a party founded by M.N. Roy. So at home was mainly these kind of discussions on society and ideology and those kind of things. So I grew up in that kind of environment. And the big thing happened when I moved to IIT, because I was in those days, people who went to IIT were from big cities. They would go to good schools in Bombay and Delhi and get to IIT. But I came from a small town, so it was a big adjustment for me. But once I learned how to navigate that, I got a lot more self-confidence. And that was a very defining period for me to become, you know, a leader or whatever. And then I was very fortunate that I missed my IIM entrance exam. So I would have been some management guy at some soap company or something. So I was looking for a job, and then I walked into this small company where Narayan Murthy was the software manager, because I had no skills. Most of my time in IIT was spent in extracurricular activities, so I didn't really learn much. And the only activity which you could go with no prior learning was software. So and that time, so I walked and he asked me a few questions and gave me a job, I think. I don't think I could have gotten Infosys after they introduced entrance exams. Luckily, I got in before that. So then I worked with Murthy, and we had a great relationship. And then, of course, Infosys began, and the rest is public history. I know that. Shall we?
Well, I think on that note, and I think wonderful question and wonderful response. Nandan, thank you so much for enlightening us on a topic of great importance for us as a country. I think the potential that you outlined for us is truly impressive. And I can only say that our chances as a country of achieving the potential that you've outlined for us are considerably greater because of people like you. Because it's people like you who really, both from your role in the private and the public sphere, make great things happen. Thank you. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Simon. Thank you.
Thanks, Simon. Thank you.